بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله حمدا والصلاة والسلام على من لا نبي بعده، أما بعد، فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. لن ينال الله لحومها ولا دماؤها ولكن يناله التقوى منكم. وقال عليه الصلاة والسلام: ما من أيام العمل الصالح فيها أحب إلى الله من هذه الأيام، يعني أيام العشر. صدق الله العظيم وصدق رسوله النبي الكريم، ونحن على ذلك من الشاهدين والشاكرين، والحمد لله رب العالمين. My dear respected listeners, it is from the infinite mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has gotten us towards the end of this Islamic year, the Hijri calendar. It is the 11th month that we are currently in, and inshallah, within a matter of days, just over a week later, inshallah, we will be in the final month, in the 12th month of 1442 Hijri, which is the month of Dhul-Hijjah. So tonight I would like to take a few minutes out to speak about Dhul-Hijjah itself and the significance of this month, the days that are to come in Dhul-Hijjah, what the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam has mentioned and so forth. So like I said, Dhul-Hijj is the 12th and the final month in the Islamic calendar, in the Hijri calendar. And after that will be the month of Muharram, which marks a new year in the Islamic calendar. And that year will be, inshallah, 1443. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala bless us all with a long life, that we see the end of this year. And inshallah, we can also commence the new year together. The year 1443. So in regards to Dhul-Hijj, inshallah, when the time comes, like I said, just over a week later, inshallah, you will all be informed based on the local moon sightings of when the month is actually going to start. But as the month starts, there's a few things that we need to note down. The first and foremost is the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentions in a Sahih hadith from the Sahih of Imam Bukhari, as I mentioned in the beginning, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam mentions that this riwayah is narrated by Ibn Abbas radiyallahu anhuma, where the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, "Ma min ayyamin al-amalu salihu fiha ahabbu ila Allah min hadhihi al-ayyam, ya'ni ayyam al-ashr." That there is no days that are better for righteous deeds, for good deeds, than these days. And those are the 10 days, the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. Now there's one thing to note down here, and that is that throughout the entire year there are significant days, times of days or months that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has made available to us to get closer to Him. For instance, we have the day of Jumu'ah, the most blessed day in the entire week. We have the month of Ramadan, the most blessed month in the entire year. Then in Ramadan we have Laylatul Qadr, the most blessed night in the entire year. And similarly, there are certain days, and the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah are those days. But the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, when you look at days collectively, not just nights, the last 10 nights are the nights of Ramadan. The last 10 nights of Ramadan are the most blessed nights. But when it comes to days, the most blessed days are the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah. So there's a lot of things that go on in the first 10 days of Dhul-Hijjah, which inshallah we will go through step by step. But as the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, these are the best days. And not just because of Hajj, that when a person is doing Hajj, it's good only for them, or for those that are on the ninth of Dhul-Hijjah there in Arafah, it's only good for those individuals, or only for those people that will be celebrating Eid and then sacrificing after Eid. No, it is generally good for everyone. Why? Because it's a good time throughout the entire year, these 10 days, to do good deeds in general. Either it be sadaqah, fasting, or doing extra prayers or recitation of Quran, whatever it may be, these 10 days are good for anything that gets you closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So now when it comes to these 10 days, starting from the first and the most important thing that happens in Dhul-Hijjah, and that is the performance of Hajj. Obviously, we know due to the circumstances around us, unfortunately, none of us from here can go and perform a Hajj, even though many of us want to. Many of us would have already even paid our packages, Hajj packages, even last year. But even this year, unfortunately, none of us can go. We'll ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to remove the difficulties and the obstacles that are in our path, and especially for those that have intended and paid and are willing to go. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make it very possible for us next year that we perform Hajj. So Hajj, one of the most important things that happens in Dhul Hijjah, and obviously it's one of the foundations. When we look at the five pillars, it's one of the pillars of Islam, that a person that upon whom Hajj is fard, that they perform Hajj. So one of the most important things that will happen in this month is Hajj. For those that are inshallah attending from around the globe, or for the locals that will be attending Hajj and performing Hajj, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept it from them. The second thing that is very important that we should note in Dhul Hijjah is the day of Arafah, which is the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, the day before Eid. The easiest way to remember it is the day before Eid, the 9th of Dhul Hijjah. This is also known as the day of Arafah, Yawm Arafah. Now, in terms of Yawm Arafah, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam mentions in a very important hadith, where he mentions, Inna Allah yukaffiru bi sawmi Yawm Arafah as-sanata allati qabla wa as-sanata allati ba'da. That with the fasting of the day of Arafah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives 2 years worth of sin. A year prior to that day and a year after. As-sanata allati qabla wa as-sanata allati ba'da. 2 years worth of sins Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgives for those individuals that specifically fast on the day of Arafah, yani on the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, and that is the day before Eid. Because obviously on the day of Eid it is haram to fast, but the day before Eid is the 9th of Dhul Hijjah, and is also known as Yawm Arafah. So each and every one of us should fast at least on the day of Arafah. Whereas another narration clearly mentions that all 9 days of Dhul Hijjah, up to the day of Eid, which is the first 9 days, each one of these days we should be fasting. There's great reward in fasting in each one of those days. But if someone cannot fast the entire 9 days and they can only fast a day or two, they should not miss the most important day to fast, and that is the day of Arafah. So that's the second thing that is important and that we should take note of and try to do in the first 10 days of the Hijjah. The next thing is the Takbirat al-Tashriq. And the Takbir of Tashriq is from the 9th of the Hijj, so the day that you will fast, the day of Arafah. So it's from the Fajr of that day until the Asr of the 13th of the Hijjah. So 5 days in total, the 9th, the 10th, the 11th, and the 12th, and 13th up till Asr on the 13th of Dhul Hijjah, we should be reciting the Takbir after every Fard Salah, irrespective of either you pray that Salat with Jama'ah or you pray it individually. If it's a Fard Salah, you have to recite the Takbir. And this is for men and women both, not only for the men that attend the Masjid, but for each one of them. A man or woman that perform Fard Salah, they should recite the Takbir. Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, La ilaha illallah, Allahu Akbar, Allahu Akbar, wa lillahi alhamd. At least once should be recited after every Fard Salah. Remember the dates, from the Fajr of the 9th of Dhul Hijjah till the Asr of the 13th of Dhul Hijjah, 5 days in total. The next most important thing that would be performed in Dhul Hijjah is the sacrifice on the day of Eid and the 2 days after. So a person, the best day is obviously the day of Eid. If he cannot sacrifice on that day, then he can do it on the 11th, the day after Eid, or on the 12th, which is 2 days after the Eid. Now, when it comes to the sacrifice, again, there are many narrations, even the verse of the Quran that we recited early in the beginning, where it mentions that when we sacrifice the animal, for us, We can eat the meat, we can give it to our family and friends, we can distribute it. This doesn't go to Allah. لَنْ يَنَالَ اللَّهُ لُحُومُهَا وَلَا دِمَاءُهَا. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala clearly mentions that the flesh and the blood of this animal does not reach Allah. What reaches Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is taqwa, the sincerity that we have, the ikhlas that we have. That is what reaches Allah, and that is what determines the acceptance of the qurban, of the udhiyah, of the sacrifice of the animal that we make. So for those of us that will be, that it is wajib upon to sacrifice, for instance, the criteria is that any Muslim that is sane and that is baligh and that is that owns the equivalent to nisab in any one of those days, 10th, 11th or 12th, any one of those days. This is a bit different in zakat where, okay, an entire year and so forth for the nisab. Qurbani is very different to that. As long as you've had, you have the amount of nisab in any one of those days, the day of Eid or the 11th or the 12th, then you have to perform qurbani, udhiyah, sacrifice of an animal or a share in a large animal, which would be a cow or a camel and so forth. Now, in regards to the fadila or the reward for this sacrifice, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam clearly mentions and narrated by Aisha radiallahu anha, and it's documented in the Sunan of Imam Tirmidhi, where the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said, "Ma amil ibn Adam min amal yawm an-nahr ahabba ila Allah min ihraq ad-dam." That on the day of Eid, on the days of Eid or the days of sacrifice, there's nothing more beloved to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala than the flowing of blood. Obviously, the flowing of blood from the animal that you have sacrificed. And in that same narration, Aisha radiallahu anha goes on to mention that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said that on Yawm al-Qiyamah, these animals that we have sacrificed will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the sacrifice of the body parts and everything will come to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as a show of acceptance, that they were accepted by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the sacrifices that we made. So for any one of us that has to do qurbani, make sure that we make the arrangements beforehand. There's still time, we make the arrangements. If you can have it done locally, alhamdulillah. If you can't have it done locally, wherever we can have it, there's many organizations that can organize for us. Have it organized beforehand so we know that during those days, our animal, inshallah, will be sacrificed. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept those sacrifices. And the last and the final thing to do is obviously Eid Salah. Qurbani, the sacrifice will come after Eid Salah. I've just mentioned it beforehand, but it will come after you have performed Eid Salah. But Eid Salah is also the final point that I want to mention, that it is also, this is the second Eid of the year. The two Eids that we have, one would be after the fasting during the month of Ramadan, Eid al-Fitr, which we have, alhamdulillah, already passed. This is the second and the final Eid of our year, the Hijri, the Islamic calendar, and that is Eid al-Adha. So again, very similar to Eid al-Fitr, two rakats of Salat. For those of us that are capable, we have to attend the masjid, perform our Eid with the rest of the community, and inshallah we'll make dua to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to alleviate from us the situation that we are in. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala reopen our masajid, remove the difficulties that we are surrounded by, the sickness, the virus, whatever it may be, so that inshallah when it comes to Eid and even before Eid, our masajid are open and the community can inshallah get back together, perform our Eid as we should, collectively, in large numbers, in large groups. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make that all possible for us. So these are just a few reminders for us as we approach the final month of the year and the important first 10 days of Dhul Hijjah. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all the tawfiq to practice. Wa akhiru da'wana anil hamdulillahi rabbil alameen.